Welcome to Frank Buckley Interviews. This time on the show, we're featuring two women who took on the establishment and won for them and for future generations of women to come. The women were sisters who became doctors. Not all that remarkable on its face, until you consider that Doctors Elizabeth and Emily Blackwell became doctors in the 19th century, when that just wasn't done. In fact, Elizabeth Blackwell became the first woman in America to earn a medical degree. It's a remarkable story that continues to resonate today in some ways, and we'll get into that aspect of women in medicine later in our program with the president of the American Medical Women's Association, Dr. Nicole Sandu of the Mayo Clinic. But first, it's the story of the Doctors Blackwell and the book How Two Pioneering Sisters Brought Medicine to Women and Women to Medicine. And I'm delighted to welcome the author, Janice P. Nimura, to the program. Janice, welcome.
Thank you so much for having me.
I wanted to ask you, the sisters Blackwell, how did you come to be interested in them? And then tell me who they were.
Well, I had written a previous book about border crossing 19th century women and knew that it was a fun place to spend some time. So when I looked back inside myself to find out what I wanted to connect to, I connected to the part of me that had started out wanting to be a doctor when I was in college, and circled around to Elizabeth and Emily Blackwell, who I had never heard of, even though I had grown up in the city where they practiced and gone to a proudly feminist all-girls school, graduated as the math science kid heading to a pre-med program. I'd never heard of them, and that confused me and intrigued me. And when I went looking for them, I discovered that they were fairly easy to find on the children's biography shelf, but that no one had really recently done a grown-up biography of them because they are complicated people. Mm. They were not sort of the traditional inspirational feminist icons that we tend to want our trailblazing women to be. They were prickly and contradictory and complicated people who changed the world, even though they weren't always in line with what we think of as 19th century feminists.
Right, because if you think about it, they were becoming doctors at a time when the suffrage movement was just starting to crank up, when this idea of women having their place in the professional world, or even having the ability to vote, was a conversation that was underway around the world and here in America. And yet, they didn't really plunge in as activists in that. We'll get into that part of the story in a second. But I want to ask you about Elizabeth first. She was the first to become a doctor. What drove her, and then how did she become a doctor?
Right. So she received her medical degree in 1849. That's a lot earlier than most people expect this story to take place. And she wasn't really called to medicine as a healer or as a scientist. She wasn't particularly interested in taking care of individual patients. She had a real sense of herself as someone who could help teach the world that women could do anything they wanted to. She really believed that humanity would not become reach enlightenment until women unleashed their own independence. And she wanted to become a doctor as a very strategic and graphic way to prove this point that women could do whatever they wanted to do by virtue of toil and talent, not sex. Mm. Medicine at this point was becoming a profession rather than a trade. And it was a profession that was credentialed by virtue of a medical degree. So she figured, if I can find my way to a medical school and attend all the lectures and pass all the examinations, who can argue that I am not as qualified as any man to be a doctor? And that's what drove her, this intense desire to prove a point about what women could do.
And yet, as we say later on, she was not about saying, hey, women, I want to join you in a crusade. She was sort of out to do this on her own. When she decided to apply to medical school, tell me about that reception and how it wasn't, didn't they even think that it was a prank?
Right. So she had received a sheaf of rejections from all of the more prominent medical schools, and her application found its way to Geneva Medical College in the Finger Lakes region of New York State. endorsed by a rather prominent physician who she had been studying with privately. And the faculty of Geneva College weren't quite willing to offend this endorsing physician by rejecting her out of hand. And so they punted the question to their students, and they said, you know, if any one of you objects to this outrageous and appalling request, we will shut it down, figuring that they were safe that way. The students saw a wonderful opportunity to make mischief and unanimously returned the answer to their faculty that, yes, sure, bring this woman along. And then they forgot about it. They figured that maybe it was a prank that had been cooked up by a rival medical school until 3 weeks later when a young woman walked into the lecture hall.
And when she gets there, does she thrive? Is she welcomed into the community of fellow medical students?
She is welcomed into the community of medical students by virtue of the fact that she leaves them all in her dust. She is much more brilliant and determined than any of them, much more motivated, really, and she quickly rises to the top of the class. And so she wins the respect of her teachers and her classmates outside of the medical college in the town. She has a much more difficult reception. People tend to assume she is either wicked or insane, because what kind of a woman would choose to study the functions of the body in mixed company?
Wicked or insane?
Right.
And I guess the context is, as we said earlier, this wasn't done. A woman wouldn't possibly go there, who wouldn't physically touch the human body, the inner workings of the human body. When people treated her this way, how did she react?
She really didn't care very much what other people thought of her. That was never her problem. She did not stop to wonder how she was being received. She really believed that this mission that she was on was a God-given mission. She thought of herself as someone with a quest to fulfill, a moral quest. And people who thought that she shouldn't or couldn't, she pretty much ignored. Mm. She liked to say that she was too progressive for the conservatives and too conservative for the progressives. She wasn't really interested in aligning herself with other groups of people. She really just wanted to make this point and assumed that if she did, the world would come to meet her.
Was it important to her that there was a woman who was providing medical services to other women, or did she just want to be a doctor? And how were women treated in medicine at that time?
Well, I think, you know, there is part of the mythology surrounding her decision to pursue medicine was the story that a woman acquaintance who was dying of some kind of gynecological illness confided to her that if she had had a woman doctor to talk to about her condition, her agony would have been much more reduced. I'm not sure whether this is truly the story that drove Elizabeth, but she did recognize certainly that there was a problem with women who just weren't able to share the details of what was happening to their bodies with someone who was a man. Mm. This was a problem. She also saw it as her mission eventually not just to serve female patients, but to also provide a place for the slowly growing numbers of women who were interested in pursuing medicine to train. She founded a hospital that was run by women for women patients and also for female medical students.
All right, we're going to take a short break. When we come back, we'll continue our conversation with Janice Nimura and pick up from there. She's the author of the new book, The Doctors Blackwell. And we're back again with Janice Nimura. Her book is The Doctors Blackwell, How Two Pioneering Sisters Brought Medicine to Women and Women to Medicine. Janice, you were talking about the infirmary created to help women and children. How unique was that at the time?
Utterly. It was the first hospital staffed entirely by women. It was founded by Elizabeth and her sister Emily, who was 5 years younger and followed her into medicine. It was founded partly because Private patients weren't quite willing to consult female doctors at the time. A female doctor was thought of as someone who probably was an abortionist or some kind of quack. The definition of female doctor wasn't what they had hoped it would become yet. So they decided to found an institution that would allow them to use the money of donors to serve the poor and to create a space for them to practice, whereas middle class women were not interested in consulting them.
You talk about Elizabeth and her sister Emily. Tell us about Emily. Was she as driven as her sister and for the same reasons?
Different reasons. Elizabeth was the first, and it was her idea. And along the way, she came to realize quite quickly that the path she had chosen was incredibly steep and lonely, and she decided she needed some company on that. The Blackwell clan, there were 9 siblings, tended to think of more highly of each other than anyone else in the world. So as a partner, she really thought maybe another Blackwell would be just the thing. And so she sort of anointed Emily, her next youngest sister, to follow her into medicine. And Emily, in fact, was more naturally drawn to science than Elizabeth was, and sort of looked about her at her prospects and said, okay, sure, I'll come along with you. So it wasn't her idea to start with, Emily's, but in fact, she became the more dedicated and brilliant practitioner. Elizabeth moved quite swiftly into the arena of public health and policy. She did a lot more writing and lecturing than actual practice, whereas Emily ran their infirmary and the women's medical college they founded, and was a surgeon and an obstetrician and a gynecologist and a medical professor.
I want to get back to something we talked about a few moments ago, and that's this idea of activism and feminism at in the context of this era. Suffrage, the idea of suffrage is starting to be talked about. The idea that women, of course, are something we accept today, our equals. Men didn't feel that way, certainly, at the time that they were becoming doctors. But it also emerges in your book that these women, especially Elizabeth, she wasn't necessarily about saying, hey, I want to join in and be your poster child.
Exactly. Ironically, the medical school that she went to in Geneva, New York, was just a stone's throw from Seneca Falls, which was sort of the cradle of the women's movement, where the Declaration of Sentiments was drafted just at the same time. And the women who were the driving force of the early women's movement really invited her to come and join them. And she refused, not because she disagreed with what they wanted. It wasn't that she thought that women shouldn't have the vote. She just thought that their priorities were a little strange. She thought that their putting the vote at the very top of the list of priorities was wrongheaded. She thought that if you gave the vote to women before they had established their independence from their own men, all you were doing was giving the men more votes because they would tell their women how to use the vote if they had it. She thought that the first order of business should be for women to demonstrate that they were independent, that they had their own opinions, that they had their own, that they could stand on their own without their men.
Well, to that end, neither Emily nor Elizabeth they don't marry and they don't have children. And was that a product of the fact that they chose a profession and therefore it had to be a one or another proposition? Were they not interested in men and children? What was it?
I think all of the above. I think that none of the 5 Blackwell sisters married, and part of that may have had to do with the fact that their own father died broke, leaving them with a clear signal that a husband is no guarantee of security. Elizabeth and Emily, I think both of them were more drawn to the life of the mind than to domestic life. I can't say for sure about Elizabeth, but Emily had a female partner for the last 3 decades of her life. I think it suited them to pursue a career over marriage and children. I'm not sure which came first, but it was definitely the right path for each of them.
We only have a few seconds left, but you have a daughter who's a pre-med student. Does this history and the context of what the Blackwells experienced versus what your daughter may experience as she goes into the world of medicine. Is there some parallel this many years later? Does it make you happy to know that your daughter can go into medicine, into a field that was that the path was paved by the Sisters Blackwell?
Certainly. There are more than half of medical students right now are female, which is something I think the Blackwell sisters would be very proud to see. I think they might not be quite as happy to recognize how many challenges women in medicine still face. It's not an easy career for work and life balance for men or women. Mm-hmm. And I think the Blackwells would be bemused to recognize how much of what they were trying to do is still undone.
Well, Janice, it's a terrific read. We thank you for the time and for the book. Once again, the book is called The Doctors Blackwell by Janice Nimura. You can pick it up on Amazon, where it's a number one bestseller. It's an amazing dive into an often overlooked part of history. Once again, thanks to Janice Nimura. When we come back, of course, when we come back, we're going to talk to a doctor from the Mayo Clinic about the Blackwell's legacy and how their impact is still being felt more than 100 years later. Welcome back. We're now joined by Dr. Nicole Sandu. She's a practicing physician at the Mayo Clinic in Minnesota and the president of the American Medical Women's Association. Dr. Sandu, welcome.
Thank you so much. It's a pleasure to be here.
You were able to hear our interview with Janice Nimura, and I just wonder this idea of the Doctors Blackwell and what they mean to women in medicine today. Talk to us about their legacy and what it means.
Yeah, absolutely. So, you know, Elizabeth Blackwell graduated from medical school, the first woman in the United States to do so, getting close to 200 years ago now. And as Janice and you talked about, her sister Emily followed her. And, you know, the legacy is fundamentally that Elizabeth Blackwell opened the door for women to walk through. Or as Janice talked about, she was very focused on the fundamental fact that women can achieve excellence as men, just as well as men can. So, you know, I think of the door being open for us to follow through as a fundamental legacy. And of course, they built their infirmary, the medical college for women that followed that, the work that Elizabeth Blackwell did in public health and hygiene, and the work that Emily Blackwell did really isn't as what we would think of as an academic physician and surgeon. So those are tremendous legacies for all women physicians and really all physicians.
Janice was talking about the fact that her family in some ways was appalled by the fact that she would choose this as a path in life. When you hear things like that today, it just seems absurd. But I wonder, what were parts of their stories that came to you and you thought, oh, that sounds familiar?
That's a great question. As I think about it, I think that women do still to some degree face similar barriers, although certainly times have changed dramatically. For example, my older daughter is in college right now, and I heard Janice say that her daughter is pre-med. My daughter is following a similar pathway, and you know, our family couldn't be any prouder. I'm not so sure that that's true of all families, but I suspect it's true of the vast majority of families whose daughters are thinking about following into a medical path.
But do women still face obstacles in this world that has been, for many, many years, dominated by men?
Absolutely. Certainly things have improved dramatically since the Blackwell sisters forged the path forward. We, as Janice was saying, slightly more than 50% of medical students currently are women, which is tremendous cause for celebration. We reached that, you know, we kind of broke that 50% barrier in 2019, just a couple of years ago. But we still face significant disparities in leadership positions as women. Only about 16% of medical school deans are women, about 18% of department chairs are women, and only 25% of professors of medicine and surgery are women. It's actually a little bit lower for professors of surgery. And professor is the highest academic rank that one can achieve. So we still face these barriers in terms of leadership positions. There's not a pipeline issue, if you will, when we see that we have parity in the number of medical students. But we have, you know, we continue to have problems with intentional recruitment and hiring, and then the support that's needed for women to achieve great success in those leadership positions. Certainly, go ahead.
No, I was just going to say, finally, I only have a few seconds left, but Janice also talked about this issue of work-life balance and how it's mm-hmm. difficult for everyone, but especially for women. Do you find that to be true?
You know, personally, I'm actually very fortunate. I have tremendous family support, but I know that I am in a minority in that way. I know most women in medicine don't have the same degree of family support that I've had throughout. Mm. And most of the domestic child care and elder care responsibilities continue to fall on women, not exclusively, certainly, but to a greater degree. And this has been exacerbated by the pandemic, of course.
Well, it's a conversation that that needs to continue. We appreciate your time, Dr. Nicole Sandu from the Mayo Clinic. We also appreciate you for what you do every day. Thanks for coming on the program.
Thank you. It's a pleasure.
And thank you for watching. We'll see you next time.